influence the last 100 years. I think that's an important idea to take away. So a critical need for India is maternal and child health. And that really is a very narrow window of opportunity, as you see here. Poor nutrition or whatever factors during the first 3 years of life impact not only underweight, but also impact height. And I'm pointing height to you as an important factor, because height is considered to be a good marker of maternal nutrition and of early childhood nutrition and also genes. So height is a very good marker of early nutrition, and it's also a very good marker of metabolic capacity, of our capacity in terms of the bone mass we have, possibly of the insulin we're able to secrete, etc. And just to put height in historical context, these are data from the Mesolithic period. This shows you the heights of six Western European populations some 8,000 years ago. In Western Europe, men were about 160 centimeters tall, women about 150 centimeters tall. This was about six different Western European populations. And they also studied three Eastern European populations. And these were heights constructed from skeletal remains, done fairly carefully, the best possible way, you know, possible. And in Eastern Europe, it was men were about 170 centimeters tall, and women, as you see there, about 160 centimeters tall. They also found skeletal remains in the Gangetic Valley and in the Indus Valley, in the Indian subcontinent. And lo and behold, these were the tallest at that time. So 8 to 10,000 years ago, your average person in the Gangetic Valley or the Indus Valley was about 6 feet tall, was 180 centimeters tall. Your average woman was about 170 or 168 centimeters tall. So clearly what has happened when you document whatever data are available, that black line is the heights of people in the South Asian, in this Indian subcontinent. The subcontinent has been losing height, which means for some reason, the per capita nutrition has probably been going down over centuries. It might be improving now, so this is something to pay attention to. This leads me on to the idea that a country like India today, when you think in terms of public health, we are facing with what we call a dual challenge. On the one hand, India, in terms of, if you scale the map in terms of the number of cases of diarrhea, the part in the middle yellow, which is the Indian subcontinent, you know, stands very prominent. And it also stands very prominent in cases of adult diabetes. So you're dealing with diarrhea and infectious disease, a huge problem. Diabetes and cardiovascular disease is a huge problem. An average Indian develops a heart attack 10 to 15 years younger than an average white person. So there is a huge problem of non-communicable disease and of communicable diseases coexisting. So the idea of India's coexistence, and I think even in this, India has to learn to coexist and co-address these problems together. So these are pictures from my friend Shivani Patel, who was in the audience today. There are these two Indias, the rural India and also some of the urban India. But when you think of urban India, don't forget that there is another urban India, which is this, the growing slums. And again, so we have to talk in terms of urbanization, of how do we create healthy cities, smart cities. There's been a lot being spoken about by smart cities, but I would argue a smart city is not just an IT-enabled city or an economically productive city. It also needs to be a city where people can live healthily, live peacefully, have intellectual discourses, and all of that. I think it's a quality of life that becomes extremely important. At the moment, India is 32% urban, and by all projection, more and more of India, like the rest of the world, is going to become urban. We cannot fight urbanization, just like we cannot fight globalization. It is an inevitable part of our future journey. So, as you see there, very soon 50% of India will become urban. It's happening in China, it's already happened in Americas and Europe. The question, but there is an opportunity. Do we have to repeat the mistakes of urbanization from other places, or can we leapfrog? I mean, I was in Bogota a couple of weeks ago, and what really impressed me about the city of Bogota, it's a developing country like India is, but they have fantastic public transportation. They have safe cycling tracks. They have managed to control their air pollution. So it is possible. And if Delhi can have a fantastic metro system, Why can't Delhi have good cycling tracks? If we are competing with Shanghai, why can't India achieve those things? Why can't we have, you know, I think the idea, people are wanting, are going to live in urban areas, people are wanting to live, have convenience, but why can't we have urban, convenient, and healthful ways of life? It's a matter of using imagination. It is not something that cannot be achieved. When you think of health, when you go to see your doctor, and I'm specifically addressing my physician colleagues here, we tend to focus on simple things like blood pressure. Your blood pressure is high, you need to reduce your salt, or I'm going to put you on medicines. Your blood glucose is high, you've got high lipids, take a statin, etc. You're overweight, lose weight, easier said than done. All of that is important, it plays a role, and I'm not undermining it. These are very important. And I think we need systems to deliver all of this in an organized, efficient, high-quality manner. There's no question about it. But equally, as a society, and as a population, through education, through policy, through other means, we have to address diets. What the diet that was correct for an agricultural society is no longer good for a modern society. In an agricultural society, you needed a lot of carbohydrates. Today, you probably don't, etc. You know, so you need to address the diet. Physical inactivity. One generation ago, people in India walked 5, 6, 7 miles a day. Women worked a lot in the field, whatever, but today we hardly move. I mean, if to cross the road, we jump into an auto rickshaw. That needs to change. Tobacco use. It's fashionable for young people to try to be, you know, it's a hip thing to smoke. You know, you go to clubs in Chennai, there people are smoking. In Jordan, in Amman, Jordan, 80% of male medical students smoke. Whereas when you go to a country like US, tobacco control is happening very rapidly. The decline in smoking is going down. So tobacco is a very important thing to control. And the other levels of risk factors, this is where policy becomes important. The underlying determinants, socioeconomic factors, impact health, culture impacts health, politics impacts health, environmental factors impact health, globalization, urbanization. And that's why a vision like Nalanda, which takes a larger purpose, is extremely important. I was talking to a couple of people here. We have departments of community medicine within schools of medicine, within medical schools. It should be the other way around. Medical schools should be within larger schools of public health. Medicine is a branch of public health. It's not the other way around when you really think about it. And if you're really honest about what you want to deliver, and also health cannot be delivered just by physicians. It's a multidisciplinary field. It requires urban planners, it requires nutritionists, it requires physicists, it requires chemists, it requires people who are experts in physical activity, it requires your anthropologists, and it requires your cultural, people studying culture to know how to influence behavior, it requires all kinds of, it requires law. How do you improve road traffic accidents? India today has the highest number of people in the world dying from road traffic accidents. Why? You have cyclists, pedestrians fighting their way between cars. Yesterday we nearly hit a buffalo on the road, thanks to our wonderful driver who was so skilled. We avoided it. Think of a simple thing like the food you eat. You might think you're buying your food from your supermarket or your corner shop, but that food is controlled at several levels. The global feed companies play a huge role in this, and this is going to happen more and more. And you do require organized food production. You do require ways of, you know, manufacturing food, ways in which food can be produced to large numbers of people, food that can be distributed without, you know, perishing. You need to reduce wastage. But the question is, how do you produce food that is healthy? And this is where a government's nutritional policies, food profiling policies become extremely important. Worldwide, there's a shortage of fruits and vegetables. On the other hand, there's an excess of refined carbohydrates. We produce a lot of corn in countries like the United States, and in countries like India, in Tamil Nadu, for example, 72% of a person's calorie requirement comes from single source, white rice, polished white rice. And governments provide huge subsidies for those things. Should we shift subsidy systems towards more healthy products? That should be an important question. Because by shifting subsidies, you can shift production. And by public health education, you can increase demand for healthier foods. I think it takes several aspects to make that work. Looking back at the United States, during the 20th century, the last 100 years, the Centers for Disease Control, which is a fantastic organization, and you know, reflected on what were the major achievements in terms of health improvements during the 20th century in the United States. And these were the 10 that they identified through a process of both looking at data and through consensus. Successful immunization, motor vehicle safety, huge issue. How many people in India wear seatbelts? I mean, I confess I was not wearing seatbelts, and I should have done when I rode a car today. Workplace safety. How many people wear helmets when they are working under busy constructions? Control of infectious diseases. Deaths in declines in deaths from heart disease and stroke in the United States. Safer and healthier food. Healthier mothers and babies. Effective family planning, showing family planning a way of improving quality of life, not just population control. I think it's a matter of improving quality of human life that you're talking about, and a way of empowering women that you're talking about. Fluoridation of drinking water, tobacco is a health problem. The problem with public health is people do not realize that this is what has made a huge difference. We often resort to medicine as if it's solving a problem. It's solving an immediate problem, but the underlying determinants of health are these. It's not the drugs that you're prescribed, it is these. And so it's important to pay greater attention to these kind of things. So to finish, there have been major recent examples of global collaboration in public health success, and one big area is the success with HIV/AIDS. There was massive global collaboration, and shown in the black line is really the increase of global resources towards HIV management, towards providing ART therapy for people with HIV, starting with the UN meeting in 1996, and then increasingly commitment from various organizations, including George Bush's global fund, the PEPFAR, etc. Global resources increased, and you're seeing there worldwide there's a decrease in deaths from AIDS and also a decrease in the rate of new HIV infection. And we are also seeing recently good documentation of improvements or declines in childhood mortality. Why should children aged below 5 ever die? They should never die before the age of 5. There might be geniuses among them who might deliver, who knows, the next great innovation. So I think it's possible to achieve it through global collaboration. But the important thing here is delivery of public health requires resources. So the Indian government only spends 1% of its GNP or GDP on health. It's extraordinarily low by any country standard. So if India wants to be a huge global power, it cannot afford to ignore health. India talks about the demographic dividend. Half of India's population is under the age of 35. Yes, it's a phenomenal economic advantage, but it will not be an economic advantage if those young people are not healthy. If those young people develop diabetes at age 30, or die of a heart attack at age 32, or develop end-stage renal disease at age 35, or develop arthritis at age 45. I think it's not going to be an economic advantage unless the health of the young people is addressed to. So that has to be done. And I don't think it can be done, as you see from here, without resources that cannot be done. So this is a conversation that needs to happen between your health minister and your finance minister and your prime minister and everybody else. I think it's a global issue. Like there was a beautiful article that I read in the Hindu that every minister is a health minister, and that should be the message. So finally, what are the major public health challenges that faces India and the world? And I say and the world because today the challenges are common. We are living, and we will increasingly live in a global village. When I travel around the world, whether I'm speaking to people under the age of 30 in New York, or in Delhi, or in Shanghai, or in Bogota, or in Oman, or in Karachi, their ideas are similar. Their values are similar, their aspirations are similar, their social networking is similar. So I think we are moving towards a global world and connecting. We owe it to that generation. We owe it to the generation to address health as a very important priority. And when you think of health, this is my list. And I'm sure there'll be other things that will be more important that you might suggest, but this is my modest list. poverty and economic disparities are important to address. And when you talk of economic disparities, I would argue it's not just economic disparities within countries, but it is also economic disparities between countries. In the year 1800, the gap between the richest and the poorest country in the world was 1 to 3.5. Today it is 1 to 300. And that has happened because of an earlier graph that I showed you, that for a 200-year period, the benefits of industrialization benefited about 10 or 11 countries, and the rest of the world, where 90% of the population lived, did not benefit, and that gap has to be closed. So we cannot talk of global equality without talking about inequality across nations and inequality within nations. War and violence, huge problem. When you go to Pakistan, the regions of Pakistan or the populations in Pakistan that are most difficult to control polio immunization are the places that have problems. And the minorities in Pakistan are the most difficult minority issues to deal with, and similarly too in India. So I think you have to think in terms of war and violence as an impediment to health and for anything, and for economy too. Climate change is a huge global issue, and I think it's an extremely important issue from several, because climate change affects health, it affects the way of life, it affects all kinds of things. And thankfully, thanks to the recent Paris meeting, I was very impressed with the Indian government's position on climate change. I think it's a very progressive position. Living environment, like I alluded to, there's going to be increasing urbanization. The question is, how do we make our smart cities healthy cities? You cannot have a smart city without a healthy city, and you cannot have a healthy city without a smart city. How do you make it possible that you can cycle to work, safely walk to work, you can meet in the corner with your friends for coffee without having to wear a mask to get away from pollution, etc. So how do you buy, fresh fruits and vegetables? How do you stop being dependent on refined carbohydrates, etc.? So all of that becomes extremely important. Safe water and healthy food. I was very inspired that there are several people in Nalanda who are working on water, on environment, etc. Extremely important. I mean, we can't always drink bottled water from plastic bottled water. Why can't we drink water from the taps? Why can't we drink water from the rivers? Why don't we go towards more, purifying the water sources in a different way, in a sustainable manner? And water shortage could become the next big human problem and could lead to wars if we're not careful. So we have to address water management very carefully. And then, of course, the conventional issues with physicians and medical professionals. We talk about infectious disease epidemic, immunization, all the non-communicable diseases like diabetes, cardiovascular diseases, cancers, and mental health. A high proportion of human populations are developing depression. For whatever reason, we have to address it. And as you see in that list, I have the health problems and my own disease quite low down, not because I'm not passionate about the disease that I research in, but I have come to the realization that these other factors are far more important from a public health perspective. And finally, we talk of medical care. I think we need systems to deliver high quality care. In the United States, in the last 15 years, we have noticed huge improvements in complication rates among people with diabetes. Somebody developing diabetes now has a lower probability of developing a heart attack, has a lower probability of developing a stroke, has a lower probability of getting his or her limbs amputated. It's because, not just because we have come up with better treatments or with better technologies, those are available everywhere. It's a matter of making that affordable, number one, but more importantly, implementing it in a way where it's done in a high quality manner. You want medicines and technology to be delivered in a manner which is appropriate. I was at a meeting of a research society in India where somebody told me, I see my patients every month. I said, you should not be seeing your patient every month. Essentially, you should be seeing your patient once or twice a year or three times a year. You should teach the patient to manage his own diabetes or her own diabetes. You require a system that monitors quality of care. Physicians should be accountable. We pay our physicians based on how many times they see the patient or how many drugs they deliver. That's a silly way of paying people. Physicians should be based on what good quality of care they deliver. So you incentivize quality rather than volume. And I think that kind of idea is seeping into the US healthcare system, and I think it's going to be extremely important. So organization of care is extremely important. And good diabetes care is always delivered through team care. It's not delivered by individual physicians. I'm sorry, physicians can know a lot, but it takes a team of physicians, a team of nurses, a team of nutritionists working together to deliver, and community workers to go and motivate patients, to make sure, and lowering the cost of technology. If a vaccine's cost could be reduced from $8, rotavirus vaccine from $8 was reduced to less than 20 cents through India's initiative, thanks to Dr. Raj Bhan, etc. So why can't the cost of other drugs be reduced? Why can't the cost of technologies be reduced through innovation? The collaboration between health and public health and engineering becomes extremely important. So finally, I'd like to conclude by telling you that all of these challenges require us to understand complexity, which means that the different parts of a system are highly interconnected. It's not enough having great doctors and great nurses, it's a matter of connecting them. So it's a matter of how do you connect media to health, how do you connect health to economics, how do you connect the different parts, and I think that becomes extremely important. And in that sense, I love this quote, for every problem there is a solution that is simple, direct, and wrong. I was saddened to read an editorial in the Hindu 3 days ago of the Madras High Court suggesting that childhood rapists should be castrated. I think that is a very simple solution to a highly complex problem. It's a solution that's not going to work. I think you have to address the underlying determinants more carefully. And it's the same thing for most of the health problems. We have to think of complex solutions and create environments of interaction, networks, communication, conversation to make it happen. And in that sense, the forces, and increasingly the forces of change, are not going to be structure or just planning. It's going to be interaction across different disciplines, networking across different disciplines, across states. There's no reason why somebody sitting in rural Bihar cannot network with somebody sitting in, say, California today. It's available. You're an email away. And I think the force of information is going to be extraordinary. You want to change things, you have to spread information. And this is where modernization of the media begins to play an extremely important role. Modernization of debate becomes important. And I want to show you the importance of information, or the lack of it, and the effect it has, with my last three slides. This is the world population shown in this graph. Clearly, in terms of land area at the bottom, when you scale the world map according to population, the Indian subcontinent looks extremely big, because we are densely populated here in the Indian subcontinent. When you look at the number of total overweight, underweight children, again, India looks huge, huge. When you look at the numbers of diabetes, India looks huge again. So here you are, a largely densely populated area with a large population, large numbers of people who are underweight, also increasingly large numbers of people who are overweight, and large numbers of people who also have diabetes. So one would imagine that great research ought to come out of this population and this region. Now let's look at research productivity. In other words, the role of important, creative, innovative information. The Indian subcontinent disappears. India contributes to about 15 or 16% of the world burden of diabetes, but contributes to less than 0.3% of the diabetes research. This has to change. And I would argue, if you're talking about a knowledge economy, then research is extraordinarily important. And I look back to my own medical school years. What disillusioned me, I was an unhappy medical student, and I can tell you when you ask me questions why that was the case. But really, the idea of just rote learning, memorizing, standardizing, passing tests without thinking made no sense to me. And I will just tell you one story about it. Amoebic liver abscess was a very common feature in India. And the pus of amoebic liver abscess had a certain characteristic. And that had been described in British textbooks as the pus of anchovy sauce. And all medical students were expected to memorize it, and they would ask you in an exam, what is the pus of amoebic liver abscess? Anchovy sauce. Oh, you get your 5 marks. Nobody, none of us had ever seen anchovy sauce. Have you? How many of you have seen anchovy sauce? So that is how silly it is. So we have not. We have to teach people critical thinking, inquiry, going back to what the 8th century Nalanda leader said: always investigate. You know, always be curious, always reason. I think that's where we are. And I'm going to stop there, telling you that, to conclude my talk, that the gaps in per capita income between and within countries is a great challenge for public health, and that needs to close. This is a political conversation that needs to happen. Civil society has to play a role here. People worldwide are living longer. We have to face the problem of aging population, and India is not behind it. It's happening in India too. Traditional norms of children taking care of their parents is changing. How do you allow older people live a life of dignity and productivity? Disease patterns are changing from childhood and maternal deaths to chronic conditions in adults. The biological adaptations to modern chronic diseases may take generations. It is easy to switch from walking to driving a car very rapidly, but our bodies don't adapt that rapidly to the loss of physical activity. So how do you deal with it? Countries like India need to deal with the dual burden of under and overnutrition, communicable disease, overnutrition, environmental pollution, and the need for public transportation, the need for energy, climate change. It's a complex, almost paradoxical, and it's a situation that a population of 1.5 billion people can solve if they put their minds together. Most public health solutions will require interdisciplinary work and information, network, interaction, not planning and structure alone, are the dominant day change agents today. And this is where R&D becomes extremely important. Investing in research and development is extremely important. India's demographic dividend depends, in my opinion, on delivering health and education effectively. If I was for 20 seconds with Prime Minister Modi in an elevator, this is the one thing that I will tell him. Dear Prime Minister, if you want your young people's demographic dividend to pay off, pay attention to their health and reform education and make it innovative if they have to compete in a world which is information driven. Modern globalization is very interconnected. Interconnection between rural and urban areas, between countries, between neighbors. And this is a place where I think India is doing well. India is reaching out to the world. And finally, this is where I think global collaboration is moving forward. Very impressed with Prime Minister Modi's travel abroad. But I also think focusing on health, focusing on education is extremely important. Thank you very much.
Education, economy, and health. It was an enlightening information for the House, and it will be disseminated also through Times of India and maybe tomorrow's edition. I would request, if you have any questions to be asked from Professor Narayan, please direct it to us right away. He would like to answer each one of that, if you could.
What is the relationship between diabetes and K2 milk? What is the relationship between diabetes and K2 milk?
And what?
K2 milk.
K2 milk.
K2 milk, he is not able to understand. It is,
Sir, I have learned too. Whereas there is two types of milk. First one is K1 milk, and another is K2 milk. K1 milk is from milk away from the Indian cows. And K2 milk is the milk produced by Indian cows.
This is something I don't know, but I can tell you a couple of things. The relationship between milk and diabetes, people have studied it. In general, particularly for young children, the comparison has been between bottled milk and breastfeeding. And breastfeeding is protective of diabetes, in both for type 1 and definitely for type 2 diabetes. In terms of milk per se, there are not much data to make a connection one way or another. And as far as K1 and K2, I have not seen data to make a point on that.
Sir, may I pay you to kindly look into this subject? May I pay you, sir?
Yes.
To kindly look into this subject?
Yes, I will do. Thank you. I would like to learn about it. Thank you very much.
Hope I help you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Narayan, this is a wonderful lecture. Thank you very much for
on karke diya.
Yes. Lecture. I have two questions to ask you. One is that, you know, you have insisted on the governmental intervention and this public health improvement because, you know, it is phenomenally low, the investment wise. That's one aspect, but as an individual, as a community, as an education institution like Nalanda, so what would be your advice that how we can reach out and how we can help in the improvement of public health? That's the first question. The second question is that, you know, when we compare the other countries, the situation in India seems to be different because, you know, there are so many number of people who could not afford medicine. The affordability, access to medicine is the big issue here because of the exorbitant cost. It is being sold on the patented medicines. And secondly, we don't have the healthcare system as such. There is no social security, there is no medical insurance. So how do you compare India with those countries and how we can improve upon?
Thank you, excellent question. Thank you very much. I'm going to answer your first question by borrowing examples from your second question. So essentially, what's the role? Your question is, what's the role of an academic university like Nalanda in this area? I mean, very clearly, you've identified two very important problems. You've identified the question, how do you make, say, medication or healthcare or technology affordable? And the second thing, how can you improve a system of care where a system can develop, and how do you educate people, etc. All of that become academic disciplines in a sense. And this is where, for example, a university like Nalanda, the purpose of academia is to spawn debates and ideas and to research into effective and innovative solutions. For example, many years ago, certain vaccines were prohibitively costly. But by investing in reverse engineering, and in different ways, they were able to come up with vaccines for pennies. So there is no reason why the cost of medication, and again, using the idea proposed by Mr. Dr. C.K. Prahlad, companies, rather than thinking of large profit margins for small populations, can think of small profit margins for large populations. Using that model, is it possible to generate medication at low cost? And I think countries like India are doing it. I was very impressed, for example, metformin in India costs 80 paise. It's extraordinarily cheap. Our pioglitazone costs 1 or 2 rupees. These are very cheap in India. So it's possible to do that. So I think lowering the cost of technology, lowering the cost of medication, and the other thing really, like for example, WHO would say, every country in its public health system, etc., should have an essential medication list. I mean, India is in the process of a national plan for universal health care. That should include. So how might that be included? And this is where the role of economics comes into play, the role of behavior and culture comes into play, and this is the role that academia would play. And in terms of quality, in terms of development of systems, like I mentioned, you would be surprised that this idea of medicine being a cottage industry was very similar also in the highly industrialized countries once upon a time. In the United Kingdom, for example, it was the 1948 National Health Service Act that ended up starting the process of organizing primary health care. India has a very good network of primary health care, but they are more used to delivering maternal child health and immunization. But it's a question of how do you modify that to address chronic diseases. And for that, you're going to require generation of good research. Research is going to be a very important role. Not just when we talk of research, people often think research is about new discovery. That's one part of research. The other part of research is how do you improve implementation of known interventions. That applied research is also equally important.
I think, so then that will also help the system. So, and there are some wonderful examples, like there is a thing called Sugavasi in Tamil Nadu, which is a small NGO delivering organized chronic disease care for people with diabetes, cardiovascular disease, etc., at very low cost. Those models can be replicated. There is the Arvind Eye Hospital, which is a master in delivering low-cost eye care to large volumes of people at very low cost. That can be replicated. There is Devi Shetty, for example, who's delivering very low-cost cardiac surgery. That can be replicated. It's a matter of how you replicate it, and the solutions might differ from place to place. But the principles of high-quality research, interdisciplinary work, of ensuring that you have measurements of quality, and you hold people who are delivering medicine or public health accountable to quality, and resourcing adequately, are all extremely important, and engaging the public in discussion are all important.
Good evening, sir. I'm Barda Gandhi from R3, and I got a great information today that environment and nutritional access is more important for health than medicine. But as a layman, I have a simple question that it's not working. Today with modernization, with modernization, we are shifting towards use of bagged foods or canned foods like nuggets or some sausages, etc. So, do you think this is healthy, and should we go for this kind of practice, or should we stop this kind of practice?
Okay, this is a difficult question, and it's a question that always comes up. Let me give you my answer on this. Okay, when you think in terms of food cooked at home, for example, it does take time. There's no question about it. And with people all working, all couples working, etc. So the requirement for convenience food is definitely a reality. It's a reality, it's a practical reality in modern day life. But the question is, do convenient foods have to be always unhealthy? Unfortunately, the growth of most convenient foods have been foods that have been highly rich in refined carbohydrates, have been highly rich in fats, for example, have been peppered with sugar and salt, for example. That kind of convenient food, of course, is unhealthy. But on the other hand, there is also a small movement towards fast foods, but which are fresh fast foods. Like, for example, carbohydrates that are less refined. You know, high-fiber breads, for example. High-quality fruits and vegetables, vegetable sandwiches, fruit sandwiches. The same taste acquired without so much salt in it. So it's a matter of experimenting with modernization and convenient food sources that are healthier. And I think it's beginning to happen. Like, for example, when you go to cities like London, for example, there is a small burgeoning of healthier outlets. For example, in Atlanta, we have whole food areas. But the problem really is two things. Number one, you have to incentivize those to be produced and opened. Second, you have to increase demand for them by consumer demanding it, and you have to make the costs affordable. So I think this is where, once again, it goes back to an important role for academia is to be searching for this. And I would argue, when you study the demise of Alexandria and the other famous library in Egypt, it was when academia lost its connection with the community that it began to fail. So questions like this, which are so important to the community, I think have to be addressed by academia and translated into policy. And this is where it would be very sad if Nalanda University came up and was surrounded by slums. You know, you want a Nalanda University surrounded with the highest quality smart cities in the world. And I think when that happens, problems like what you're suggesting, you end up having healthier foods because people are going to demand it, the academics are going to work on it, the industry is going to manufacture it, the costs are going to come down. So I think it's that goes back to the importance of interaction.
Why from girls from Africa right over to India? Where the left X was left, number
one.
You said about why from girls migration, population migration.
Right.
You said about why from girls.
Yes.
Did the why from girls leverage X part surveillance?
See,
See, number.
Okay.
And you referred about US health indices. Is that best in the world? What about NHS? Number three. Bharat versus India. But you said only India. We have two names of this nation, Bharat and India. The India depicted, that was the whole metropolis, all the big cities. And Bharat is really the villages and the developing or the smart villages that we are thinking of. That is there. And war of waters, you rightly said, but over here we are having 70 hours under groundwater. And if you are able to harvest this baggage water, they will have 24 hours water. And we are working on that. Impact. Over here there won't be any war of waters. And curry sauce and red currant jelly, we have not seen.
What is the last point?
And curry sauce and red currant jelly, we have not seen.
Okay, so let me answer your question in the order which you asked them. The first, the data that I showed you from that map was from the Genographic Project and IBM, and they were able to track the Y chromosomes. And I think more recent tracking the X chromosomes is a little more difficult. I mean, I would, you know, so the according to the knowledge we have about the Y chromosomes, in fact, I sent my saliva and buccal smear and got my own migration map. The idea was that a small group of people came directly to India, to south of India, and that group probably also went to Australia. And there was another group that went up into the what is today the Middle Eastern region, and then to Central Asia, and then came into India and to other parts. Again, this is based on the best available genetic information. Your second question is a very important question. I use data from the United States, and I spoke about the US healthcare system because I work there. And there is a lesson here. Among the rich countries in the world, among the OECD countries, per capita, the US spends the highest in terms on health. It spends about 16% of its GDP on health. In fact, a high proportion of public funding, half of it also on health, so it's a very high spender. But in terms of outcomes, in terms of health outcomes for the people, US is among the lowest among the rich countries. And there is a lesson here. The National Health Service you mentioned is a publicly funded universal healthcare system. Denmark, I was in Denmark recently, it's a universal healthcare system. Sweden has a social insurance-based system. In the US, we spend a lot. For the highest, the top 20 or 30%, we deliver fantastic care. For the average person, we deliver good care. But for the bottom 20 or 25%, we deliver miserable care. So again, I would not argue that the US healthcare system is a model to replicate. I mean, there are some good aspects to the US healthcare which is worth borrowing. I think where the US is very strong is in research. I think where the US is very strong is in the area of quality improvement, etc. The US is also quite strong in terms of keeping up with a certain modernization. Like, for example, if you look at cancer statistics, US has one of the best survival rates in the world. But models like the UK may have certain other lessons that are more useful to India. I think it's a matter of that. Then your third question, I didn't make a note of it. Your third question was?
Bharat
and India. Okay, I agree with you. I showed you data on urban Chennai. I didn't have time, but I do have data in rural parts of India. So I think those rural, let me call the rural parts of this country. In the rural parts of this country, particularly in Tamil Nadu, diabetes rates are going up. Rural parts of Kerala, rates are going up. But then when you go to certain underdeveloped parts, etc., there it's different. If I was to make a prediction, in 30 years' time, you're going to see everything becoming quite similar. I don't think that you're going to have this kind of difference in terms of health and disease.
So it's not at 30. It's just saying, whatever people used to eat, whatever you used to do, this is what the sweat every day. Nowadays, people are not sweating. They are eating well, doing everything well, but they are not sweating every day. And this could be one cause of making them of many kind of things.
No, I mean, I'm a great believer in physical activity. I swim every day. And I think, yes, that is a good point. But on the other hand, we should not forget the fact that in 1950, the life expectancy of India was less than 30 years. Today, it's closer to 65. So people are living longer. There are benefits to modernization. How do you balance the benefits to the cost?
That's the last question.
Of course, the Vice Chancellor and Mr. Manoj Roy. I would request the Nalanda University community to remain seated here. The rest of the team.
Yeah, I'm going to go.